Good evening and welcome to Views with Joyce Waddell. Thank you for joining us this evening. We have a very interesting program for you. We're going to be talking about where do we go from here? Where do we go from here? And I've heard that expressed in many, many different ways. As we look at things that are happening in our community, things that cause disturbances, things that we don't control, but some kind of way brings a lot of grief, unrest, hatred to our community. That's not the America that we dreamed of living in. That's not the America and the country that we want. That's not the community that we want it to be. We hear the words often, black people, police, white guns, thank God, justice, training, decision, race, understanding, brutality, accountability, crime, watch, protect, murder, blame, choke, sorry, vocal, black, breathe, change, community, friends, kids, life, injustice, pain, agitators, corruption, guns, cop, stop. These are words that we're hearing much too often, much too often. And we're going to look at a clip right now from Texas. And we've heard so many different versions of this, so many different versions of it. So sometimes we don't even know what to believe. As we look at the swimming pool party that turned into what we didn't want it to be. At the party, we saw all kinds of signs held up, white man, race. What caused this eruption to take place in Texas at the swimming pool party? One of the versions that we've heard, what we saw repeatedly, was a large, heavy-built white cop with his knees in the back of an African-American girl, and she was wearing a bikini bathing suit. Is that what we want to see in America? I don't think so. Is that the way we want to see conflict handled? I don't think so. What prompted this? What prompted to just get out of control? One of the things that we do know as we see this happening is that the video cameras are alive and well. They are documenting things that we never thought they would document. They are letting us see things that we never thought they would see. We've heard so many versions of that pool party, but one of the things that we're hearing from the 911 calls is that the police came when they were called for a domestic disturbance. That was one of the calls, and that was one of the ways someone documented it and said, that's what happened. We do know that we saw the girl that we see her now on the ground with the police dragging her. The video camera took that. The cell phone showed us that. That's a clip we never want to see. We never want to see in this country happening. Was this young lady so out of control that the police had to put his knees in her back? And they heard him say, no, you put your face down. As she tried to breathe, he said, I want your face down. And there was a young man jumping up and down saying, oh, look what's happening, as he was pointing to this, a teenager. What was captured on that was the words that says, hey, you get your butt out of here. Other policemen were around trying to say, that's enough, don't take it any further. You're really taking this too far. We know what happened next. The community was outraged. They didn't know what was going on. Is this what we want to see in America when we say, where do we go from here? Is this what we want to happen when we have to make decisions about where do we go from here? A community of unrest. A community that's crying out for justice, for equality, for policemen to be retrained, for police to keep their hands off their guns at times when it's not necessary. And as the teenagers gathered around making noise, we saw him put his hands on his gun. We saw him take that gun and start moving forward with it and pointing it. How outraged they were. Is this the kind of thing that we want to see when teenagers gather together for a pool party and it gets out of hand and adults begin to fight with children? So adults are in the midst of something that they could bring calmness to, but instead they continue to incite other teenagers. We must train children also. You don't jump around and cause disturbance. And there was one account that said this could have been prevented. All that was needed to prevent it was for the adults to take charge and be adults. And this is what we didn't see in Texas. That's the latest, or one of the latest events that we have seen when we talk about where do we go from here. We've been asking that question. We have a long ways to go from here. We have many, many miles to go before we sleep, as the poet Robert Frost put it. And miles to go before we sleep. That incident was an incident that sparked this whole country into rage, mainly because here's an adult male holding down a teenager. He has the strength and the power to do something different. That should never be seen. And that's something that went all over the country. YouTube, network television, local television, communities, churches. Is that how we handle disturbances? Is there a better way? There should be. And so, as we continue with our topic, where do we go from here? We look at other things. We look at other things that are cited. Before the summer, as we go back to the summer, before the summer of 2014, we had seen Eric Garner dying on a Staten Island street and Michael Brown lifeless in Missouri sun for hours before the grand jury decision and the die-ins that shut down interstates. We may have lured ourselves into believing that the struggle was over, that it had been taken care of back in 1964, the 50 years ago, that the march and bloodshed had established once and for all the basic rights of people who had been at the bottom for centuries. May have believed that, if nothing else, the civil rights movement had defined a bar beneath which we could not fall. That doesn't seem to be the case. It seems to be we're still answering the question, where do we go from here? Still seems to be that we are in the crossroads, in the midst of violence, in the midst of police brutality, in the midst of deaths on the streets, violence in the neighborhoods, looting, disruption of a community. But history tells us otherwise. We seem to be in a continuing feedback loop of repeating a past that our country has yet to address. Our history is one of spectacular achievement, as in black senators of the Reconstruction era are the advances that culminated in the election of our first African-American president, followed by violent backlash that threatens to erase the gains, and then a long, slow climb to the next mountain where the cycle begins again. Is it a cycle that goes around, gets better, and then turns out to be worse all over again? Is this the cycle that we want to see as we address the question, where do we go from here? The last reversal of black advancement was so crushing that historians called it shame. It came after leaps African Americans made after enslavement during the cracked window of opportunity known as Reconstruction. The newly freed people built schools and businesses and ascended to high office. But a conservative counteraction led to a gutting of civil rights laws of that time and to the start of a Jim Crow caste system in the South that restricted every step an African American could make. Are we coming back to that now in a different sense? But the kind of treatment we're receiving, the kinds of things that we're seeing recorded with our people on the streets. Audience, we continue to ask the question, where do we go from here? And we're gonna pause to take you to some music, some sights and some sounds as we come back and continue to talk about 6 million African Americans filed that caste system seeking asylum in the rest of the country during what would become the Great Migration.
Oh,
audience, we're continuing to talk about where do we go from here as we look at our past, as we look at where we are at present, and look at the things that are so vitally important to us in the future. We've looked at what we saw happening in Texas at the pool party most recently, and how it really brought a lot of unrest to a community, how it disturbed many of the residents of the community, how getting along with your neighbor meant not getting along with them at all and fighting. We saw how adults behaved when they could be bringing peace and calmness. And that's why we're asking, where do we go from here? As we think about the past few months, we've been forced to comfort our place and to look at our place in a country where we were enslaved for far longer than we have been free. Force us to face dispiriting erosion that we have witnessed in recent years, from the assaults on a string of our black president to the gutting of the Voting Rights Act, that we had believed we were successful in achieving. And now police assaults on black people for the most ordinarily human behavior. A father tasered in Minnesota while waiting for his children. A motorist shot to death in North Carolina while seeking help after a car accident. It is as we have a rate of police killings now surpassing, just going far greater than the rate of lynchings during the worst decades of the Jim Crow era. There was a lynching every 4 days in the early decades of the 20th century. It's been estimated that an African American is now killed by police every 2 to 3 days. The same thing. The outcomes in Staten Island and Ferguson and elsewhere signal a time as in the time of Jim Crow. And that's why we ask, where are we going? Are we at a standstill? As we compare the early turn of the century, the lynchings, and how terrible and painful they were, to the killings that we see in our streets today. For this, we have learned that the journey is far from over and that we must know our history to gain strength for the days ahead, that we must love ourselves, even if, and perhaps especially if, others are not loving us. And we must care about what happens to ourselves first and be a blessing to others in our community around us who we come in contact with each and every day. We must most of all keep faith even as we work to make our country live up to its creed. And we must know deep in our bones and in our hearts, if the ancestors could survive it, the Middle Passage, as brutal as it was. And they did survive. If they could survive that, then we can survive anything. And so, as we ask the question, where must we go from here? We must know that we must move forward. We must use the strength that we have to make positive steps that are out there and that are necessary. And one of the educators, her name is Melissa Harris Perry, wrote in her novel, The Bluest Eye, that Toni Morrison explores the profound vulnerability of a young black girl living in poverty in a world that values wealth and whiteness. Toward the book's end, her psychic, emotional, and physical destruction is nearly complete. We are invited to see her tragedy through the eyes of the child narrator. I felt a deep need for someone to want the black one, just to encounter the universe, to be loved. Because as young children, when they got their dolls on Christmas for birthdays, they got the white doll. And that's what they saw. And that's what they wanted to be like. And as we go further than that, an experiment was done with children of color. They were presented a white doll and a black doll. And they were asked to choose which one did they prefer, which one they thought was most beautiful. They didn't know. They knew what they had seen. And so they chose the white doll. They hadn't seen a black doll before. And as the experiment goes on, maybe the black doll was not. It was human made. Maybe it wasn't made to look the prettiest. I don't know what the experiment showed, but it's been reported over and over that the moral to the story is that's what they had been taught, what they had been indoctrinated with, that white is better, that white is more successful, that white is what you choose. So the young children knew no better, and so that was what they chose. So, audience, in this moment, there's a need for someone to want and to embrace blackness, to be proud of the color of the skin that we have. Another one of the famous writers, Shirlane McRae, the first lady of New York City. She attended a Boston meeting of grandmothers who had stepped up and taking responsibility for their grandchildren. So she had some things to share and some things to say to them. The grandmothers and great-grandmothers, she wanted them to be successful, so she gave them success stories and how they must step up to do their part to help children to be successful. She also said to them, I think we must acknowledge that being a police officer is a tough, tough job in the face of real physical danger. The officers are required to maintain their professionalism and composure. They have to sort out the so-called bad guys from the good guys without resorting to stereotypes, and they must do all of this while respecting the dignity of everyone that they serve. In addition, it was said that Eric Garner was killed in an encounter with NYPD officers, and I mourned the step backward as the community reflected on the death of yet another unarmed black man, like many. I wonder what will it take to build a relationship of trust between communities of color and the police they serve. And so to answer to the question, we move forward with strength. That's where we go from here. We move forward with the strength that we have, and we make this community the best that it can be. As we go forward, each person has a responsibility and a role to play, and we must play those roles. Audience, we want to thank you for being with us on Views with Joyce Waddell. I want you to tune in next week for another interesting program.